Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to President Lincoln's Cottage and our second annual Lincoln Ideas Forum. My name is Erin Carlson-Mast, and I'm the executive director here. Please take a moment to silence your cell phones. We are recording this so that we can show it online after the fact. I also want to draw your attention to the hashtag for this program in case you want to follow it online, contribute to the conversation online now, or look at it afterwards. It's hashtag Lincoln Ideas. That's on your program for today. We've also given you a few other things, including the transcription from last year's program and the lyrics to a song that we'll be playing during today's program. But because of the acoustics in this room, we thought it would be helpful for you to have the transcription of those lyrics as well. We launched this program last year on the 150th anniversary of Lincoln's last visit to the cottage, the day before his assassination. And the idea was to explore the intersection of President Lincoln's life and legacy with contemporary issues. Our goal is really to commemorate the ideas Lincoln created and the work he accomplished while living here, as well as to highlight all of his unfinished work. President Lincoln's Cottage is a home for brave ideas, not only because of what Lincoln accomplished within these walls, but because of the conversations that continue to happen here every day. Today, we look forward to hearing how Lincoln's ideas and the outcome of the Civil War and Reconstruction continue to influence our present and what can be done to improve freedom and equality. It is my pleasure to introduce our moderator, Ted Maris Wolf. He is the Vice President of Education, Research, and Historical Interpretation at the Abby and George O'Neill and the Abby and George O'Neill Director of the John D. Rockefeller Jr. Library at Colonial Williamsburg. He is the author of Family Bonds, Free Blacks and Reenslavement Law in Antebellum Virginia, and is also one of the creators of slaveryandremembrance.org, a partnership among Colonial Williamsburg, UNESCO's Slave Route Project, and more than 50 museums and historic sites around the world. Maris Wolf received the 2015 Georgian N. Richards Prize for his article of Blood and Treasure, Recaptive Africans and the Politics of Slave Trade Suppression, published in the Journal of the Civil War Era. Please join me in welcoming Ted Maris Wolf.
Good afternoon. It's wonderful to be here in this home and in this room in this home. We were just speaking about animism in other places of the world where inanimate objects or so-called inanimate objects speak all the time. And we are in a room that speaks and a building that speaks in a place that speaks to us all. We're often asked why we have museums or why do we preserve spaces for the future? And there's no greater answer than what Erin and her team have created here. It's a space that's preserved so that we can meet and have these kinds of conversations anchored to present day issues. And who knows where we'll go this afternoon. So I'm just the moderator, but I have a few remarks to try to get our minds together. And I did my best to weave together some of the themes that we're about to hear so that in conclusion, after our speakers have spoken, the great hope is that we'll have a conversation about ideas, a freewheeling, informal conversation inspired by the ideas that are launched toward us this afternoon. Lincoln once declared that writing, the art of communicating thoughts to the mind through the eye, is the great invention of the world. Great, very great, in enabling us to converse with the dead, the absent, and the unborn at all distances of time and place. For Lincoln, words, whether spoken or written, crystallized ideas into projectiles, into mystical vectors sent out to shake and recalibrate the universe. Lincoln observed from a young age that an idea is only as good as the words chosen to convey it. And Lincoln never forgot that ideas through words can change the world. Lincoln recognized the power of words first as a boy who lacked language ability, and then as an adult who had acquired the right words and had mastered their release through timing, tone, nuance, and punch. Like our distinguished speakers here today, Lincoln believed that ideas and the words that carry them forward, whether through the letter of the law or heartfelt inspiration, can lead to behavioral and societal change. Words can change me, they can change you, and they can change the world we live in. Lincoln saw firsthand how words can convert a peaceful cornfield into a bloody battleground. Words can incarcerate, torture, and kill. Words can help to erase or make it impossible to forget. Like today's speakers, Lincoln recognized that words can make real, relevant, and urgent what before seemed abstract, far away, meaningless. Words can spur action where there is ignorance or complacency. Many of Lincoln's words portray him as standing between history on the one hand, and on the other, the idea that America's founding was incomplete, yet to be realized. For example, in one of his first public speeches to the Young Men's Lyceum of Springfield, Illinois, Lincoln sought to mark the meaning of being alive in America in 1838, not only for himself, but for all the young people present, and also the nation. The American Revolution and the pillars of the Temple of Liberty who fought it were fading upon the memory of the world, he said. The revolutionary generation has, he lamented, quote, crumbled away. The solution? Words. A call to young people to quote, supply their places with other pillars, hewn from the solid quarry of sober reason. Marvelous 18th century language there. Would our politicians speak in that way? Words that helped his audience recognize that we were, in 1838, a nation in need of new founders and much more founding. In short, America had yet to be fully realized. In one of his later writings in December 1863, Lincoln outlined the process whereby loyal Southerners could be pardoned, along with restitution of their personal property, excluding slaves. Again, Lincoln marked this moment by standing between an untarnished memory of a unified republic at its founding and judicious amnesia of recent and current events. Like so many of Lincoln's writings, his proclamation of amnesty and Reconstruction was inherently forward-looking, with little mention of the turbulent present. And amnesty, by the way, is Greek for forgetfulness. Perhaps this will come up in a later conversation. How the Civil War ended mattered a great deal to Lincoln. In its ending lay the seeds to future cooperation and reunification. Through words, Lincoln believed he could help shape the war's ending, define its meaning, and begin Reconstruction. Like Lincoln, each of our speakers today is moved by ideas and makes a living through words and the powerful ideas those words convey. And we are here together in this home for brave ideas in the very room where the most brave ideas live. Who knows where we shall go this afternoon? Let me just say a word of housekeeping, that our speakers will be brilliant for 18 to 20 minutes before they get this. And in between speakers, we will have a 1 to 2 minute intermission. So you can stand up and stretch as we change the mics. And we will come together after our fourth set of speakers and have a conversation inspired by what we've heard. So without further ado, let me get down to business and introduce our first speaker. Catherine Chong is the director of the Office of Trafficking in Persons within the Administration for Children and Families at the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. She advises the Assistant Secretary by providing subject matter and expertise and overall leadership of anti-trafficking activities under the purview of the Administration for Children and Families. The Office of Trafficking in Persons is responsible for the development of anti-trafficking strategies, policies, and programs to prevent human trafficking, build health and human service capacity to respond to human trafficking, increase victim identification and access to services, and strengthen health and well-being outcomes of survivors of human trafficking. She does a lot. The Office on Trafficking in Persons collaborates with federal partners and other government and non-government stakeholders to raise public awareness, identify research priorities, for the Administration for Children and Families anti-trafficking work and make policy recommendations to enhance anti-trafficking responses. Prior to government service, Catherine was the co-founder and president of Polaris, establishing the global organization's innovative programs to assist victims of trafficking and to expand anti-trafficking policies and fundamentally change the way communities respond to modern slavery. Catherine received her degree in psychology from Brown University and an MPA from Harvard Kennedy School. Please join me in welcoming Catherine Chong.
Well, it's a pleasure and honor to be here with you in this very sacred and holy room where President Lincoln drafted parts of the Emancipation Proclamation. And during this week, where Friday, Washington, D.C. will be commemorating Emancipation Day as well. And so it's a very historic time to commemorate the spirits of the generations that came before us, and an honor to be able to share with you how much we've learned over time in terms of what we're doing against human trafficking and modern forms of slavery today. So I wanted to start off by sharing a little bit of my personal affection and inspirational moment of what Lincoln means to me personally as leading this effort at the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, and then give you a sense of what modern forms of slavery and trafficking look like today. What lessons can we learn and are we learning from the Reconstruction era, and what does it all mean as we collectively move forward? So first off, if you were to visit my office at the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, I have a framed drawing of Abraham Lincoln standing on the porch, right? I think this is the back of the house with the columns. And he's just looking into the distance, looking downtown towards where the White House is. And sometimes I imagine, like, what was he thinking in that moment? It was a drawing in the evening of when he's coming home to rest here. What's on his mind? How is he thinking? The country is developing and progressing. And I have it right next to my desk because then it reminds me of if he were alive today, how would he perceive the way the country continues to develop and evolve and progress in our modern day fight against forms of human trafficking? So what does human trafficking look like today? There are so many, in many ways, we've advanced in terms of our economic, social, structural developments. We've developed politically where the issue of human trafficking is a very bipartisan supported issue, which may seem rare in these political times, but it is an issue that a lot of people across diverse spectrums can get around. But then there are other similarities to the conditions that enable human trafficking today that were around and similar to the conditions historically. So, for example, if you think of the various forms of human trafficking today, many of which are driven by specific economic incentives and dynamics. So we see human trafficking cutting across the types of services and products we consume every day. So slave labor and forced labor in the fruit that we may be eating, vegetables, agriculture, the minerals that may be making up compositions of the electronics that we consume. It's all a lot embedded in the global supply chain. So it is very much part of our reality today as it was back then. It's just that we're a much more globalized economic engine, and it's harder to tell where certain products are coming from. And human trafficking is also, though, embedded in individual, so it's not just the global economy, but there have been cases investigated across the country by federal and local law enforcement where the people are forced into labor in small businesses, in people's homes as domestic servitude, as well as illicit industries. So forced labor in drug trafficking, people smuggling, exploitation in the commercial sex industry. And so there's a wider range of markets that are touched, illicit and legitimate, by modern forms of trafficking. And then in regards to the social conditions, we have learned over the last 15 to 20 years, when we first thought about human trafficking as an issue, we thought it was transnational in nature. And the trends that we've seen over the years are similar to the trends we saw in the past of what made people vulnerable to trafficking. So today, the disconnection, social isolation, and stigma that many populations experience make them highly vulnerable and to the point where traffickers are proactively targeting them. So refugees and immigrants, unaccompanied minors crossing the border, fleeing violence and persecution in their home countries, runaway homeless youth. Among runaway homeless youth here in the United States, LGBTQ youth who are disproportionately impacted, those fleeing poverty, looking for economic security, and then also those who've experienced many other forms of violence prior to experience human trafficking. So we find that those who've experienced child abuse, maltreatment, neglect, those who've witnessed domestic violence, those who've lived in communities that have been influenced so much by organized crime, they are also very vulnerable to the trappings of and recruitment tactics of human traffickers. So those are certain similarities that have cut across the eras that our country is still confronting today and the world is still confronting today. So when I think about where we are today, and particularly the historical lessons during the Reconstruction era, also timely for the event today is that the very existence of the Office on Trafficking in Persons within the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services is new, but not so new to this country, because in March 1865, President Lincoln signed a bill for the Bureau of Refugees, Freedmen, and Abandoned Lands, otherwise known as the Freedmen's Bureau. It was a very short-lived bureau, but we can talk a little bit more about that in our conversation. But essentially, the bureau was constructed because the country was faced with a really big set of questions of, now that those who were once in slavery are free, how are the economic and social institutions and educational, health, and welfare institutions going to be able to address the millions that are coming out of slavery? And just like back then, today we're dealing with that same question. For those who were once trafficked, and some from a very young age, how do we help them transition into lives of social and economic equity and sustainability? And so the nearly 150 years after the establishment of the Freedmen's Bureau, the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services established the Office on Trafficking in Persons to do very similar things that the Freedmen's Bureau was set out to do. So taking care of food, clothing, basic essentials of being able to rebuild a person's life post-slavery, post-human trafficking, addressing the health and medical needs of victims of trafficking. And we know from those we've served directly and that our grantees have served that across the country, victims have many different needs, from medical to dental to mental health service needs. And then the very important needs around education and particularly economic self-sufficiency. How do we address those needs when many victims and survivors of trafficking are already so behind in their educational achievements, or many victims may also have other forms of developmental disabilities that traffickers have preyed on, or lack of access to perhaps many of the things that we've had access to. So those are the questions that we're addressing now as a country, just as we addressed back then. And the lessons that we've learned, or that I'm coming to learn from the Freedmen's Bureau and its establishment, is that first, yes, words absolutely matter, of having words in a statute or legislation or policy document, whether it's creating this office or enabling services for victims of trafficking, including those who are trafficked into this country without documentation status. There are legal words on paper that enable them to access certain benefits and services to the same degree as refugees. And just like back then, there are U.S. government officials today making those determinations of, I see cases every day of children who are crossing the border, fleeing very violent circumstances, coming into violent circumstances of trafficking here, and determining, is this a case of trafficking, and does this case warrant services and benefits to the same degree as refugees? So it's eerie to see some of the similarities to 150 years ago and the incredible progress we've made, but also the human needs that we continue to have to address in the United States. The other lesson that we've learned is that if you think, for those of you who are much more familiar with the Freedmen's Bureau or the Reconstruction era, the Freedmen's Bureau, after President Lincoln was assassinated, was essentially disbanded by President Johnson. They had certain early successes around reaching educational goals, not as many successes in regards to economic self-sufficiency and obtaining abandoned lands and transferring them to those who are now, who were once enslaved and now living in freedom. There were much more challenges and obstacles towards that economic achievement of the goals. And then ultimately, the Freedmen's Bureau was disbanded due partly to insufficient political will across presidential administrations, insufficient funding and commitment. And so, yes, words matter, but all the actions and the people in place to then implement those words will carry and determine how long and how much progress we could make as a country and society to enable continued progress. And so the main lessons that we have learned, just to wrap up for this part of the talk today, is how much have we learned about the economic and social root causes that enabled slavery, all the isms that we talk about right now, racism, sexism, classism, some of the policy decisions that are getting made, and how does that make certain populations more vulnerable to trafficking, and what can we do to prevent that vulnerability? Those are questions that we're actively asking right now. And then the second question is from an institutional U.S. government response, and then also local community response, what can we learn from the successes and failures of the Freedmen's Bureau and the Reconstruction era of the past? And here we sit 150 years from that period, but 150 years from now, when there's another group, hopefully, in this building, how much progress will they be looking back at us and say we've made or we're not able to make due to political and economic will or lack of will? And so, during the conversation, I look forward to hearing your questions and sharing additional lessons learned and trends that we're seeing now that are not so different from the trends that we experienced in the past, and some are quite different due to the modernization or the modern times that we live in. So I thank you for your attention and look forward to the conversation ahead.
Okay, we will march on. Our second distinguished speaker is Dr. Richard Vedder. He's a distinguished professor of economics at Ohio University, director of the Center for College Affordability and Productivity, and an adjunct scholar at the American Enterprise Institute. Dr. Vedder has written widely on American economic history, authoring such books as Out of Work, Unemployment and Government in 20th Century America, and the American Economy in Historical Perspective. He served as a member of Secretary Margaret Spelling's Commission of the Future of Higher Education, and is the author of Going Broke by Degree, Why College Costs Too Much. We may have some current students in the audience who can speak to this. Dr. Vedder is also the author of numerous scholarly papers for journals in economics and public policy, as well as shorter pieces for the popular press, including the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Post, Christian Science Monitor, National Review, Cato Journal, and Forbes. He received a BA from Northwestern University and an MA and PhD from the University of Illinois. Please welcome Dr. Richard Vedder.
Thanks, Ted. And following up on Catherine's good way of starting, I probably should talk about my association with Abraham Lincoln. Although I am easily the oldest speaker in the group, I did not personally know Lincoln. I grew up in the land of Lincoln in central Illinois. My house was located less than a mile from a courthouse where Abraham Lincoln practiced law. I grew up six blocks from a magnificent statue of Lincoln done by Laredo Taft, where I used to play on as a small kid, probably somewhat sacrilegiously, but nonetheless with a lot of enjoyment. I want to speak about five transformative events that happened during a period of just 300 days, actually 280 days, in the years 1862 and 1863, events that I think cumulatively are as important of events as ever happened in any 300-day period in American history. And slavery and the African-American experience is part of this, but it's not the only part of this. So let me begin. What are the five transformative events that happened? The first occurring on May 20th, 1862, the last occurring on February 25th, 1863. Here are the five events. No PowerPoint, you know, very Lincoln-esque. I call this West Virginia PowerPoint, which will probably, I'll use my fingers, which will probably offend a lot of people. Not very Lincoln-esque either. But the five points. First, the five events. First, the Homestead Act. The second, the Pacific Railway Act. Third, the Morrell Act. Fourth, and the most glorious, of course, the Emancipation Proclamation. And fifth, the National Banking Act. All five of these happened in Lincoln's period, tenure in office. Let me say a little bit about each one of these. The Homestead Act of May 20th, 1862, allowed settlers to receive a quarter section of land, 160 acres of land. After residency on that land for 5 years, they became owners of the land. They could buy the land outright even after 6 months of living on the land for a very low price, $1.25 an acre, $200. $200 was more than it is today, but still a reasonable price. It was legislation that had previously been vetoed by James Buchanan during his tenure as presidency. So Lincoln took something that had been thwarted, and because of the Civil War, and this is true for almost all of this legislation, would never have happened except for the Civil War. He signed this legislation and supported it. This legislation extended the westward movement. The land was largely arid land. There's a lot of research since that says, well, it wasn't the best land. The best land had already been given away for railroads, grants to railroads, and in some cases, land grants to colleges, which we'll come to in a minute. But it was still a commitment to westward expansion. And incidentally, interestingly, most of the land given away under the Homestead Act was given away after 1890, much later than during his life. It was a great act of privatization in a way. We took something that was a government-owned, something the government owned, and gave it to individuals and said, this is yours. This is yours to work. So it's interesting. At the time Lincoln was born, the center of population of the United States was in Loudoun County, Virginia, not too far from here. At his death, the center of population was in South Central Ohio. The country moved roughly 5 miles a year westward. And I think events like the Homestead Act and the one I'm going to talk about next, the Pacific Railway Act, had a lot to do with this. So Lincoln was a champion of westward expansion and very forward-looking in that respect. The Pacific Railway Act happened on July 1st of 1862, and it authorized the incorporation of the Union Pacific Railroad, which then was, which by the way, in the interest of fairness, I must say I'm a stockholder in. I think you're supposed to say these things these days. Which then tied into the Central Pacific Railroad of California and created the Transcontinental Railroad, which of course wasn't completed to 1869, but the ability to do it was created because of the Pacific Railway Act. It was the construction of these railroads were aided by government loans, massive land grants, and of course it led to the opening in 1869 of the Transcontinental Railroad. It revolutionized travel and communications between the East and West, again, accelerating the westward movement, the integration of our nation, and again, it was also, it's interesting, we were able to construct this massive construction, largely in some sort of under private auspices, but with some government support. So it was sort of a public-private, an early example of public-private partnership, I think you could say. Let me turn to the third of the five things that I mentioned. The Morrell Act, which came, was signed the day after the Pacific Railway Act, July 2nd. That was a busy week for Lincoln in 1862, besides, you know, dealing with wars and a war and so forth. Justin Morrell was a congressman from Vermont who had been pushing this legislation for years. It had been vetoed in 1859 by James Buchanan. He liked to veto things, I guess. But it was approved in 1862. It was the law that created land-grant colleges in the United States, which we have all over this country to this day, dozens of them. By the way, the vote to approve it was 23-19 in the Senate. So even with the South out of the Union temporarily, it barely passed, but it passed. And as one writer on educational history put it, quote, land-grant institutions have helped transform the basic nature of American society. Another writer has written, quote, the Morrell Act set the stage for the most distinctive and most successful example of public service by American universities. All of these things that I've talked about so far involved land and the granting of land. It was our great resource, our cheapest resource, our most distinctive resource, and Lincoln was capitalizing on that resource in a way to help the nation. So those are all very important. But of course, all of these pale in significance to the Emancipation Proclamation. And it is, of course, was issued on January 1st, 1863. It was the very idea was formulated apparently in this very room. This is a sacred ground. It was the most important presidential executive order in the history of the United States. It was, of course, the Civil War was America's most important war, the most difficult war. It's a war before we even talk about the racial issue, 2% of the nation's population died in the war. Not male population, not adult population, total population died in the war. The war cost us 2 years of national output by the most conservative estimates. And the freeing of the slaves had enormous economic impacts that we don't have time to talk about today because the czarina on time is not going to let me. Slaves in 1859-1860 earned very little in the way of cash in their work. But they did receive some food, and they received some housing, inferior as it may be. They received some sustenance, obviously, to keep alive. There's a lot of literature on this. Most writers think that the slaves were getting $30 or $35 annually in benefits, call it compensation for their services. But they were adding about $90 on average to the income of the slave owners. We call that the marginal productivity of labor in economics. So they were exploited over 60% of their income. 60%. That means they're making 60% less than a comparable free person would be making doing the same thing. The slaves were, at the time of the beginning of the Civil War, were worth, in market terms, over $4 billion. That's more than 1 year of the national output at that time. That would be like saying we have some resource worth $18 trillion today that is there only because of human exploitation. That's why it was there. And that's what Lincoln was trying to do. He was trying to get rid of that $18 billion of exploitation, and he did. The biggest example of income inequality in American history was eradicated in large part, not totally, by the Emancipation Proclamation. I once estimated in a paper I wrote 45 years ago, about a third of the way back to the Civil War, it seems, that blacks in 1860 in the United States, on average, had 25% of the incomes of whites. Now, remember, this is a time where all people were poor by today's standards. But the black incomes averaged about one-fourth of that of the whites. After the Civil War, and allow for a few years, we know we didn't go to utopia. For the African-American population. We knew about Jim Crow laws, and we know about Reconstruction, all the perils that it had. But black incomes in 1880 were about 50% the average of whites. They doubled relative to whites in less than a generation. And indeed, if you look at black incomes relative to whites today, they've moved up some more. The biggest single gains that blacks received in their lifetime relative to whites occurred because of the Emancipation Proclamation. White slave owners lost $4 billion of wealth, which meant many of them were bankrupt. It led to a wholesale change in the South. I want now, last, to talk. I don't know how much time I have. 1, 2 minutes, 3. I'm doing okay, I think she's saying. I'm a college professor with tenure, so I don't pay any attention to this anyway. I want to talk about the National Banking Act of February 25th, 1863, which was later amended in 1864 and again still amended to this day. It created something called national banks. It taxed state bank notes that state banks had, banknotes, currency, out of existence. It led to a uniform currency for the nation. It led to the federal government's first regulatory agency, the Comptroller of the Currency, which still exists to this day. It enormously lowered the cost of simple transactions by vastly reducing the problems of counterfeiting. Used to be every bank had their own banknotes. How do you know if they were legit or not? It helped finance the Union in the Civil War, and that's where Salmon P. Chase comes in, who, and this is the great-great-granddaughter of Salmon P. Chase, who is going to follow me speaking. Secretary of Treasury to President Lincoln. And they had to finance the Civil War. And one way to do it is create a new category of banks and make the banks keep as reserve U.S. government bonds. So one way to get people to buy bonds of the Union government was to create a new category of banks where they had to buy those bonds. Very clever, by the way. And it helped finance the Civil War, but in doing so, it created something that exists to this day. Now, Lincoln's role in passing much of this legislation was more passive, I would say, than FDR's in pushing the New Deal or LBJ's pushing the Great Society. After all, he was consumed by the Civil War. As Stephen Ambrose said of the Pacific Railroad Act, Lincoln supported it as time would permit. The bottom line, however, was great transformative change. The common theme here, people's choices were expanded. People's working choices in the case of African Americans, the people's choices with respect to education, with respect to the land-grant colleges, and so forth. Lincoln was a great believer and supporter of human freedom. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Just another word about the conversation that we'll have at the end of this, our series of speakers. We're really envisioning this to be less of a traditional Q&A session with questions and answers volleyed back and forth. But I'm certainly scribbling away, taking notes, and I see that many of you are. We have a number of questions already that seem to be threading their way through these talks. And I'm looking forward to an engaging conversation. It is a great pleasure to introduce Olivia Stokes Dreyer. She is the executive director of the Karuna Center for Peacebuilding in Amherst, Massachusetts, where she has worked since 2001. The center was founded in 1994 to help address the growing challenges of ethnic, religious, and sectarian violence. Ms. Dreyer's international experience includes the development, design, and delivery of programs in peacebuilding, intercommunal dialogue, and reconciliation for diverse stakeholders in over 20 conflict-affected countries. Ms. Dreyer recently led a two-year interfaith reconciliation program with 160 Buddhist, Hindu, Muslim, and Christian religious leaders in eastern Sri Lanka, and a program in the Great Lakes region of Africa focused on building the capacity of local groups to break interconnected cycles of communal and gender-based violence. From 2002 to 2012, Ms. Dreyer also directed the Conflict Transformation Across Cultures graduate certificate program at the School for International Training in wonderful Brattleboro, Vermont. Earlier in her career, Ms. Dreyer worked with the Gandhian movement in India on rural development and non-formal education. After returning to the U.S., she served as a community mental health practitioner over 20 years. Ms. Dreyer holds a BA in psychology from Yale University, a master's in social work from Smith College, and a master's in public administration from Harvard University's Kennedy School of Government. She is also the great-great-granddaughter of Salmon P. Chase. Don't forget that. Please join me in welcoming Olivia Stokes Dreyer. Welcome.
Today, in this talk, I'm hoping to give you a little bit of a report from the trenches in a way that I hope will bring insights and ideas that will layer on to the other talks we've heard and feel really relevant to some of the dilemmas we face in this country here and now. And in thinking about doing this talk here today, I was struck by how prescient Lincoln was, that while the Civil War was raging, he was already thinking about economic, political, and social reconstruction. That he had these great ideals that the country had to be founded on the equality of all people. He held up the sanctity of the Union, but he was also a political pragmatist and realized that this would take a long, long time and require great political compromise. And I think those two levels of idealism and pragmaticism are so critical to the work that I do. Over the last 20 years, there's been a worldwide epidemic of civil war. I think many hoped that with the fall of the Berlin Wall, the end of the Cold War, it would usher in an era of peace. That did not happen. Ethnic, religious, sectarian violence has spread like wildfire. The reasons are complex, too many to go into here and now, but to name a few, I think the Cold War held certain tensions in abeyance as the US and the Soviet Union propped up their client states, that the deep divisions left from the legacies of colonialism were bound to erupt sooner or later. Worldwide political leaders, as we well know, are very skilled at manipulating fear, at manipulating divides to bolster their own political and economic gains. And I think there's something about the forces of modernization and globalization, this vast migration into cities, that has been so uprooting. And there's a sense of clinging to older, more solid-seeming identities. And when these identities come under attack, they can be clung to fiercely. But in these wars, we're seeing a new, though perhaps maybe very old, kind of warfare. This is no longer armies against armies. It's all kinds of militias, and unfortunately, civilians are caught in the crossfire. There are many more civilian deaths than combatant deaths, and tens of thousands displaced. There are now 60 million displaced people in the world. It's the highest number since World War II. These wars, especially where neighbors turn on neighbors, are totally destroying the social fabric, negating trust. And what happens in about 40% of countries that do achieve peace is they're back into war within 5 years. It's not surprising. These are cycles of violence. There's a culture of violence that's created. So the great question for me and the others I work with is, how do we break that cycle of violence? How do we reweave the social fabric, rebuild the trust that healthy societies absolutely depend upon for functioning? So in thinking about this question with you, I have three goals. I want to make vivid for you the challenge, but I also want to share some stories of hope, where against all odds, people are reconciling even after the ravages of brutal, brutal civil wars. And in fact, in my experience, in some of the situations where people have seen the very, very worst that human beings are capable of doing to each other, there's this deep, deep longing to create a different future for the next generation. And that longing is something that can really be capitalized upon. And third, most of these positive stories are happening in the developing world, and we hardly hear about them. We hear the horror stories. And I think we have tremendous lessons to learn from them, some of these successes, and that's why I want to lift them up. I'm going to do this with three brief examples from three places where I've worked, from Bosnia, Sri Lanka, and Rwanda. And as I give you these examples, you'll hear some basic principles, basic assumptions that we work out of. The first is that lasting peace is not achieved either through a military victory or even through a negotiated settlement. It's built brick by brick through an integration of economic, political, and social reconstruction. And that for the social reconstruction, which is really our specialty, it's necessary to address what actually happened, to look at the root causes, to hear about the grievances on all sides, to address the trauma of war. And that means the trauma for the victims and for the perpetrators, for those who were dehumanized and for those who committed acts of dehumanization, which can be just as traumatizing. Otherwise, we continue with this culture of violence. Third, that it's really important to establish a sense of hope that it is possible to reconcile, that it is possible to have a shared future, as difficult as that may seem. Fourth, that these efforts have to be locally led, really built on local culture and traditions. And fifth, that it's really hard work. Two steps forward, three steps back, one step forward, four steps back. And yet it can happen. So for the first of these stories, we worked in Bosnia after the war with educators because we felt they would have a direct impact as refugees were returning to each side. And I want to tell you about Fahidin, a young Bosnian Muslim man who was our youngest participant. He was 14 when the war broke out in 1992. And his sister called from a neighboring village to say that there were Serb militias committing massacres in nearby villages and that the family should leave immediately. They hesitated. They couldn't believe it. They had lived with their Serb neighbors peacefully for generations, attended the same schools, gone to each other's religious festivals, but they did go. And they spent the next 3 years in a refugee camp in Slovenia. 2 days later, the militia did come to Vahidin's village. Sadly, 300 people were massacred, ranging from babies to grandparents. 60 members of Vahidin's immediate family were killed. When Vahidin returned to his village 3 years later, he said it was in shambles. But for him, the most shocking thing was to learn that the man who led the militia that led the massacre was the principal of his school, a man whom he had revered as a child. He said at that moment he felt his heart turned to stone. He hated Serbs. He wanted revenge. He became an imam. He embraced his religion, his identity, his Muslim identity, and he taught religious studies in a school. His principal suggested he come to our program. He came reluctantly. He wanted nothing to do with Serbs. But bit by bit, he actually became one of our most engaged participants, and he now runs his own peace-building NGO and works on bringing together Bosnian Serb and Bosnian Muslim youth. I asked him what shifted for him. He said it was a gradual process, but that in listening to the Serb participants, he gradually started to walk in their shoes. He understood something about the fog of war. He understood how terrified they were, that they believed the propaganda, false propaganda, that they were hearing. They heard rumors of concentration camps, but couldn't believe it. And they carried terrible guilt, burdens of guilt for what was done in their name. He vacillated, he said, for a long time between compassion back to hatred, back to compassion, but eventually realized that the hatred was destroying him. And that if there was to be any kind of future, it was a shared future, and he would rather work as a peace builder. Unfortunately, efforts like Vahidin's in Bosnia aren't terribly supported politically or economically, for that matter. Economic and political reconstruction have been slow, but those examples do matter. In Sri Lanka, we worked with religious leaders after a 27-year civil war. Briefly, a Hindu-Tamil minority never believed that their rights would be respected in the Sinhalese Buddhist-majority country. They had plenty of evidence to think so, and they started a war of separation. It was a brutal civil war that went on for 27 years with atrocities on all sides. It was settled with a military victory by the Sinhalese majority. And when we started working in the East, which had been the front lines of the war 2 years after it ended, there was peace on the surface, but tremendous tension underneath. And what had happened was not being discussed at all, let alone the concerns for the future. The government said, we have no ethnic problem. We only need economic development. The Tamils felt otherwise. The root causes had not been addressed. It was difficult work. There was a lot of mistrust. We brought these religious leaders together over time. They engaged in deep, deep dialogue with each other, many of them speaking to each other for the very first time. Slowly, they began to share what had occurred for each of their groups during the war. Perpetrator and victim were not so clear. And they began to recognize how everybody had suffered and how their country had suffered, how they had been manipulated by their political leaders. And gradually they became very enthusiastic about bringing their communities together in joint projects. They rebuilt each other's religious sites. For example, in a Muslim village, they hosted Buddhists, Hindus, and Christians for a week in their homes to rebuild their mosque. It was the first time anybody from outside of their religion had been in that village. And they did this in many communities. They did joint microeconomic projects. They had Sinhalese youth learning Tamil and vice versa. Once the religious leaders gave it permission, soon the youth were texting each other and happy to reconnect. They created interfaith councils to stop new conflicts before they grew. They began lobbying at the national level against discriminatory policies that still remained. And they collected rescue stories because they recognized there were many instances where one ethnic group had risked their lives to rescue a member of another. But these stories don't get told. We estimated that their efforts reached some 5,000 community members, so it can have this tremendous ripple effect. Happily, in Sri Lanka, there's a new government as of a year, and I think the political and economic reconstruction will start to move forward. In Rwanda, it's one of the most challenging places I've worked, but one where the stories of reconciliation are also perhaps the most moving. As you well know, in 1994, they experienced a horrible genocide in which an estimated million Tutsis and moderate Hutus were slaughtered in a period of 100 days, largely by machete. Our so-called international community stood by, dithering about what to do. Eventually, an army of Tutsi exiles in Uganda came in, took over the country, and to their credit, set up a mixed government, and then set about to rebuild the country. For them, perhaps the biggest challenge was justice. It was estimated that 300,000 or so people had participated in the killing. It was state-ordered, or at least state-encouraged killing. Many Hutus were afraid that if they didn't participate, they would be killed. And so they set up this grassroots justice process with village-level justices. And people were urged to speak the truth about what they had done. And if they confessed, sentences were reduced, and they were allowed to do community service instead of prison time, reconstructing homes for the vulnerable, contributing in all kinds of ways. I remember talking to one man who was part of this program, who had been part of a gang of killers during the genocide. And he told me, "I did terrible, terrible things during the genocide, but I'm so grateful to my government for allowing me to be a human being once again." It's actually tremendous when you think about that. So in Rwanda, our work has been more on the government level with ministries, with the Ministry of Reconciliation, with justice, sort of advising on this process, but also very much at the grassroots level. It's totally mixed geographically. So trying to understand how these communities can live together again, how as people who killed come back and are living side by side with family members of people who were killed, how on earth can you move forward together? And we're working with a wonderful group of Rwandan Quakers who have created a joint trauma program where they're working with perpetrators and survivors together, where they recognize how they were both affected by the genocide. And youth who are gathering positive stories of reconciliation to spread through social media. So in thinking of these examples, I hope you see some common threads. One is our interdependence, that we really have no choice but a joint future. King famously said, we must learn to live together as brothers or sisters, or we will die as fools. That this kind of reconciliation is possible. It takes the courage to confront our past and to really be willing to understand those with compassion who we've thought of as our enemies, to understand their fears their concerns, to be able to walk in their shoes. And that it's a very, very challenging process that takes time and that individual acts can matter hugely. So I want to leave you with this question. If the Rwandans can do this after genocide, if Sri Lankans can do it after 27 years of civil war, if Fahidin could do it after losing 60 family members, what is it that we can do to address our legacies of violence and that which still divides us from those legacies? What is the challenge and what is the opportunity that's there in the Black Lives Matters movement? What does it mean if we just let it die down and simmer away and all those tensions go back underneath? What's still in the DNA of the South from the humiliation of defeat? How does that continue to live on? What is the legacy from the massacres and forced marches of Native Americans? And what new divisions are we creating in our incredibly polarized political discourse? What would it mean to really live into the perspective of someone with whom you totally disagree politically? To try to understand the world from their point of view and the experience that shaped that perspective? And what new divisions are we creating between the so-called Western world and the so-called Islamic world? And what divisions are being fostered here at home between American Muslims and non-Muslims? At Karuna Center, we feel tremendous responsibility to address those divisions as well and have started working on race dialogue in campuses, on dialogues with Muslims and non-Muslims in our communities in Massachusetts. Because I think the world is full of really cautionary tales of what happens if we don't address those legacies. But it's also full of some really inspiring stories of what can happen if we do. So thank you.
We have a special treat. Our final team is a team of two, actually a team of three, who joined us today. I'm going to be introducing two of them. Katie Mansfield is the director of the Strategies for Trauma Awareness and Resilience Program within Eastern Mennonite University's Center for Justice and Peacebuilding. Katie has also worked with the Mennonite Central Committee Kenya for 3 years as peacebuilding coordinator and at Notre Dame's Kroc Institute, researching, writing, and network building with initiatives in Colombia, Argentina, Thailand, and Nepal. Prior to working in peacebuilding, she worked for 8 years with a major multinational bank in New York and London. Katie's a PhD candidate in expressive arts and conflict transformation with the European Graduate School in Switzerland. She completed her MA in international peace studies at the Kroc Institute in 2008 and her AB in history at Harvard University in 1996. She's joined by Raymond Ziegler. Raymond has been in and out of prison since he was 8 years old. He was released from prison in 2010 after serving 20 years. In 1981, he was sent to Camp Hill Prison for voluntary manslaughter and learned through taking the GED that he could not read or write at third grade level. While serving the 20-year sentence, he enrolled in a business management course with Montgomery County Community College, earning an associate's degree. He later received a scholarship from Villanova University and received his bachelor's degree. Since his release from prison in 2010, he has been in treatment for bipolar disorder and for trauma stemming from his home environment and prison experiences. Today, he's employed at Greater Philadelphia Asian Social Services as a certified peer specialist. His responsibilities include weekly drug and alcohol outpatient group sessions, writing drug and alcohol progress notes, and helping men and women with employment and peer support. He looks forward to combining studies in the MA in Conflict Transformation Program with coursework at Eastern Mennonite Seminary. Please join me in joining Katie Mansfield and Raymond Ziegler in their presentation.
Black race is founded on two-thirds a person. Rapings and beatings and suffering that worsens. Black human packages tied up in strings. Black rage can come from all these kinds of things. Black rage is founded on blatant denial, squeezed economics, subsistence survival, deafening silence and social control. Black rage is founded on wounds in the soul. When the dogs bite, when the bees sting, when I'm feeling sad, I simply remember all these kinds of things, and then I don't fear so bad.
You took my son away from me. You know how hard it was.
Black lives matter.
Black lives matter.
Yeah, black lives do matter.
My name is Raymond Ziegler.
And I'm Katie Mansfield.
And we are in search of emancipation. In Michelle Alexander's book, The New Jim Crow, she tells of an interview she had with a minister in Waterloo, Mississippi. And what I want to read this interview to you. It's a hustle. Felony is the new N-word. They don't have to call you a nigga anymore. They just say you're a felon. Once you have that felony stamp, your hope for employment, for any kind of reintegration into society, it begins to fade out. Today's lynching is a felony charge. Today's lynching is incarceration. Today's lynch mobs are professionals. They have a badge. They have a law degree. A felony is a modern way of saying, I'm going to hang you up and burn you. Once you get that, you're on fire. And I'm burning. I'm on fire. Again, my name is Raymond Ziegler. And I just got finished doing 20 years at Greatest Four Penitentiary in Pennsylvania. Yes, a crime I did commit. However, I paid my dues to society, but yet I'm on fire. Even with a Villanova degree, I'm on fire. Even working for the Mental Health Association of Southeastern Pennsylvania, receiving certification as a certified peer specialist, certified forensic specialist, I'm on fire. The same places let me do an internship, working side by side with city employees. But when a position came open that I was more than qualified for, and supervisors went to bat for me, guess what? They would not hire me. I'm on fire. Damn it, somebody help me put this fire out. Many of our African-American young males and females that are incarcerated, when they reenter back into society, they are on fire. I'm tired of it. I'm tired of it.
Today, the topic you'll see in your program is the legacy of slavery. How do we face the legacy of slavery? How do I trace the legacy of slavery from slavery to you and me? Your people suffered, and then we're free, right? And we shake our heads at history. I once was blind, but now I see. Haven't we all been long set free? Is there something that keeps me from engaging the fuller history? James Baldwin wrote to family that whites, like me, quote, are trapped in a history they still do not understand, and until they understand it, they cannot be released from it. Wait, I need to be set free? What do we mean by legacy? Isn't colorblindness empathy? Or is it time to see?
Discrimination is real, daily. Mass incarceration policies, a way to deny participation, preventing real emancipation.
Okay, step back. Can I profess on historical trauma and participatory induced traumatic stress? Trauma comes from the word for wound.
A wound must be lovingly dressed, but first it must be cleaned.
Addressing historical harms. We've learned from Indigenous teachers. Maria Yellowhorse Braveheart describes the Lakota historical trauma response, quote, a constellation of features associated with massive group trauma across generations, such as the 1890 Wounded Knee Massacre and the removal of children to federal boarding schools. Navajo activist Mark Charles asks, why is it so unaddressed that the historical foundations of the U.S. rest on genocide and slavery? Participatory induced traumatic stress, he answers his own question. White folks unable to process the blood on our people's hands. And of course, that might be easy if we could place it back in distant time. But what we mean by legacy is that we're still engaging in these crimes. And so back to the legacy and aftermath of enslavement.
What is a legacy? Beliefs, ideas, mythologies, prejudices, biases, behaviors we disseminate and inherit.
For example, I got here all on my own merit.
What is an aftermath? Institutions, laws, political, economic power structures, the official narratives conveyed and enforced by society supporting systems, like education and religion, social services, criminal justice. The aftermath, the systems enforce or reinforce particular aspects of a legacy.
Prequel. Declaring independence, we said all men created equal, but we had to clarify. With a 3/5 compromise, a black body is property, therefore just counts partially.
Dred Scott sued for his freedom, but courts denied him that. In fact, denied citizenship to any black.
The Emancipation Proclamation didn't quite set black bodies free.
It provided black soldiers to the Union, threatening the Confederacy.
13th Amendment, 1865, finally, the law arrived, banning slavery and involuntary servitude. Of course, law is different from attitude. And there was an exception. The ban did not apply to the punishment of crime. The ban did not apply to the punishment of crime. Civil Rights Act, 1866, 14th Amendment, 1868, full right to citizenship, overturning both Dred Scott and that old 3/5. 15th Amendment, 1870, universal suffrage, male that is. And of course, we have some loopholes, voter registration and literacy test hoops.
But what to do now to rebuild? Let me repeat that. What to do now to rebuild? Round them up for convict leasing, even cheaper source of labor, conditions worse than slavery. And oh, Jim Crow, 90 years of separate but equal, bombing, lynchings, lynching mob violence, civil rights struggles, eyes on the prize, we look to a more promising sequel.
I sang with many. Rosa sat so Martin could walk. Martin walked so Barack could run. Barack ran. He ran and he won so all our children could fly.
A black president Yes, we have seen it. People of color, all kinds of achievements.
Yet, if I want to understand the reality of discrimination, if I want to develop some potential solution, look to the bottom, I'm told. See the whole context, social, historical, indignity, distress.
Let's look to the bottom of this wound before we wrap it up. Oh no, now the new Jim Crow. Instead of emancipation, we have mass incarceration, implicit bias, stigmatization, schools to prison pipeline, brutalization. Can our children walk safely while black in this nation?
And I want to believe we've come far. We are learning. I feel more heat and my stomach burning when I hear of another youth shot. When I look to the bottom and I find that black women are the fastest growing incarcerated population. 1 in 10 black men with high school diplomas serve time in prison or jail. Of black men who dropped out of school, 37% are incarcerated, more than a third, compared to less than 1% of the general population. How can I accept that, quote, prison time has become a normal life event for African-American men who have dropped out of high school? And even in school, studies of zero tolerance reflect small-time infractions bring disciplinary actions which affect disproportionately minority and especially African-American youth.
A racial caste system, living stigmatizations, criminal records change everything. The old exception, the ban did not apply to punishment of crime. And punishing crime, we can continue to ban people by law and by custom, from mainstream society to social mobility.
So today, as back then, there is something to abolish. Today, why do we not have more abolitionists? Black Lives Matter activists invite a wagging finger or even get called terrorists?
Is that what we call abolitionists? And civil rights activists? Where's empathy on our list? Can the people at the top look and listen to the ones at the bottom?
In trying to heal historical harm, individual or collective, this is one of our manuals, we explore 4 core responses. Face history. Make connections. Heal wounds. Take action. Let's say those again. Face history. Make connections. Heal wounds. Take action.
Is that what we call abolitionists again? And civil rights activists. Here, facing history means facing slavery and its legacy and its aftermath. If we connect in honesty, rage at desperate realities, we may find a path to healing these wounds. We may identify how our stories fit together, listen to each other's truth.
With such loving preparation, we may yet reach emancipation.
As you see, this poem is uplifting but sad. Trauma is a serious, serious disease. We all are traumatized at some point of our lives, and we all walk around traumatized. In the African American community, we have a high rate on black crime. high rate of incarceration. In the African-American community, you have a low employment rate, but yet high recidivism rate. In the African-American community, what is our plight? Could you tell me? What is our plight, Miss Katie?
I think we just did what we could to lay it out. And it is our plight. It's not just yours.
So how could I say Black Lives Matter?
Black lives do matter.
Can we all say Black Lives Matter?
Black Lives Matter.
I don't think y'all serious about this. Can I say Black Lives Matter?
Black Lives Matter.
One more time. Let's say I'm good. Black Lives Matter?
Black Lives Matter.
That's what I want to hear. Thank you.
We have just about a half hour. We're going to stay on time here. Let me just say a hearty thank you, not only to Aaron Mast, but to Callie Hawkins and the team.
Yes.
There's a kind of magic that one uses to assemble a panel of speakers, and not everyone has that magic. And boy, does Callie Hawkins have that magic. So I think you don't really need me on the one hand. The questions are in the air. Let me just say a few thoughts. I'll launch a few of the questions you've already heard in a slightly different way, and we'll just open it up. Historians are obsessed with the question of how does change happen? And this is really at the root of most historical thinking and writing. How do we measure change? What does change mean? What is our relationship to the past? In studying African American history in particular, it seems to be one of hope and resilience on the one hand and of tragedy and trauma on the other. How do we balance that to make sense of what happened in the past, but also in how we teach it? What is the function of that which we study when we're conveying it to youth and to try to build something better in the future? And how do we do that with a traumatic past that we're trying to make sense of? Why hasn't slavery ended? We're enlightened people. Folks in the 1850s were speaking about how enlightened they were, and so were the ancient Greeks. Why hasn't slavery ended? Did the Civil War end? Did Reconstruction end? Did it really ever begin? Beginnings and endings, I think, are worth exploring here. How do we know when something's ended? How do we change the words on paper? Law, codified act, it's easy stuff sometimes. What is the distance between words and lived reality? And that distance, what does that look like? This is where the truth lies, perhaps. Why is there a distance between the ideals documented in the 18th century and the lived reality for so many today? Why? Were we ever reconstructed? What stories get told and preserved and conveyed, and what don't? Why isn't the news better? What is the function of a story in the purpose of constructing an everyday life? And usually we think of wars as being destructive, of course, for good reason. But we heard from at least one speaker here how constructive the Civil War was, the American Civil War. How many acts were passed that really created, I would argue, a new nation. That the nation by 1870 is not the same nation that was founded in the 18th century. It's a different United States. And maybe the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments alone tell us this, including the Civil Rights Act that was commemorated here a few days ago. So let's see where we go. What inspired you? What do we need to ponder collectively here? And where is it going to take us in this room so we can take it somewhere else when we leave? Yeah.
Black lives matter.
Black lives matter.
Well, why don't they matter to black people? Why are there more black on black crime?
Because of trauma. We've been taught. We're taking it inwardly, and we express it outwardly against each other.
I might invite Darshiel to talk into this too.
Sure.
I just also want to say that the term black on black crime is kind of like a misnomer because studies show that because races tend to live in communities with people of their same race, that white on white crime is also, I think, about 80% of white homicides are committed by white people as well. And so I think the term black on black crime is also kind of like a politically charged term that was used to kind of stigmatize black communities when really most races actually commit crime within their race at equal degrees. So I just also want to throw that out there as well. And if we look at like cycles of violence and also just segregation and who lives by whom, most crime is also committed by people that you know. And so if we live in the segregated kind of nation or, in segregated communities, then it just would follow that those statistics would be that way. But I just want to caution everybody that when we hear that term, black on black crime, especially used in the media, just kind of challenge a little bit, why is it being used and who does it benefit to use that term versus using the term white on white crime?
I think we're struggling with legacies here, particularly of the 13th and 14th Amendments. How is the law equally applied to everyone? And we clearly have a large segment of our population that feels that the law isn't applied to them fairly and equitably. And we have a number of social and political legacies here, as well as economic legacies that inform, I think, your question, which can take us really to this notion of healing. How do we have a conversation about whose lives matter or don't in a way that begins to heal society in a productive way? How do we do that?
I think I would just throw out, at Eastern Mennonite University, where is our center of daily life, there is a program called Coming to the Table that was actually founded by descendants of enslaved people and descendants of slave-owning people, sometimes from the same plantation origins, to start conversations and family reunions to dig into their own personal histories. And it's actually out of that project that this manual I held up, which is called Transforming Historical Harms, was developed. And in their framework, as I mentioned, there are these four steps that they call out. And the first one is facing history. And as you could probably tell from our presentation, we believe that this facing history step is a really important one that it's very difficult. I mean, it's certainly very difficult for me as a white person to face the history and the legacy of that history as it is currently playing out in the lives of my brothers and sisters. And there are these three other steps of making connections, and Coming to the Table demonstrates that very well. The last one is taking action, and why am I losing the third one right now? So facing history, healing wounds. Healing is what we're talking about. And that healing process, we said let's get to the bottom of that wound before we wrap it up. And so none of these are a step one, step two, step three, step four, but the healing goes on in the connecting process, in the facing history process. That song we played at the beginning, she said, then I don't fear so bad. But the things she's listing are actually things to be feared. They're actually awful things. So it's hard to process. Well, why is it that now I don't fear so bad? Well, the name of the song is Black Rage. So, okay, I don't fear this so bad because I'm understanding the history that underpins what is playing out now.
So this is a question for everyone in the audience. We've heard from folks at a center, from a university, from a nonprofit, and from federal government. Whose role is it to undertake these kinds of conversations? Is it a part of, is it a function of education? Is it a function of religious groups? Who should be carrying forth these kinds of conversations in your communities?
Everybody. I mean, there are arguments in my mind for every one of those institutions to carry the ball. I mean, I don't think you can put the ball all on one of the institutions. I mean, foundations have a role, churches have a role, the government has a role. Everybody has a role. So I don't think you can actually put on the shoulders of one element of our society.
You're leaving out the family.
Yeah, I mean, any one of those things.
Who needs to be healed?
Well, I think everybody does. The minorities need to be healed. The majorities need to be healed. So again, at risk of overstatement, again, I think it's a joint problem that society in general has to bear the responsibility for this.
So related to that, the question that we heard with our first speaker, why hasn't slavery been abolished? Generally speaking, why have we not, in all our various organizations and institutions and families, been able to solve this issue in the 21st century?
Have we not institutionally abolished slavery? I mean, I'm not denying that it exists some, but institutionally, I think we have. So we've made some progress. And give us a break.
But even in the 13th Amendment, you know, like as the poem stated, that, you know, there it said, you know, we abolish slavery except in these cases. And so that left it open. And then you have, you know, newer kind of like the war on crime and stuff like that, that kind of inserts in there and, you know, creates systems. So in a way, it never left.
I guess I do try to look on the good side. I'm thinking that, do you realize that the Koch brothers and Mr. Obama are sort of agreeing on that we have to do something about the incarceration situation in America, where we imprison more people than any other country in the world, even though we're only the third largest?
Yes.
Yeah. Have some hope.
And I think you raise a valid point here that should be underscored. Give us a break. We've made progress. So those of us who are involved in education, museum, institutional education, how do we balance this journey by conveying the progress that we've made, but also conveying the work that's yet to be done, the unfinished business that Lincoln's Cottage speaks about? How do we do that, and what does that balance look like?
Well, I think when we think about human trafficking and modern-day slavery, it's no longer about color, it's about gender. And so it's a new way of looking at slavery that we have trouble in this country. Look at pay equity. You know, it's not slavery, pay equity, it's not slavery. But if we are enslaving women and girls in our own country, in the United States, human trafficking, and that's what we call modern day slavery, we still haven't come to terms with respect for women and girls. And so that's something that we need to work on. And if we work on that, then we can get to the root of taking one step forward and four steps back and
many of our speakers have worked with issues of gender equality in various contexts, nationally and internationally. I wonder if one or a few of you would like to speak to what's worked. How do gender issues become important and made important to solve such problems?
It's, I'm an economic historian, and it's interesting to note that in 1950, say, what proportion of the income of America was earned by women? Women, maybe 20%, 25%. What percent is today? 40, 45, not 50, but much closer. This goes to the gentleman's point. We give us a break. We have made significant progress. The great move to having greater female equality in jobs and occupations has occurred less because, I think, of laws, or the laws have played a role, than because of change in human attitudes. Somehow it is cool, it's acceptable, it's expected that women not only work, but they work in responsible positions, that they become CEOs, that they become doctors and lawyers, to the point that now 57% of the people going to college in the United States are women, 43% of men. When are we going to get male equality back? One might argue. I'm not pushing that point. But the point I'm making is that institutional change through laws is one thing, but there are other factors at work, and markets are at work too. That's all I'll say. I could go on and on, but we're almost out of time. So.
Yeah, one of the things that we've done, we've noted that around the world where you see gender programs in developing countries especially or around gender violence, it's mostly women that just show up. And then there started to be these men engaged programs for men to start to look at their roles. But what we've started now is what we're calling men and women as partners in peacebuilding, and we've interwoven both the peacebuilding aspect and gender-based violence and trafficking. And really for men and women to start to recognize their joint responsibility in actually working together on this issue in the community, at home, in the family, everywhere, and that it's very, very intertwined. To me, it's a little bit analogous to recognizing that Black Lives Matter can't be an African-American movement. It has to be a countrywide movement. Mm-hmm. It's a collective responsibility. So I think it's that partnership that's really, really critical.
What degree does gender play in terms of the policies that you're trying to create and enforce?
So it really depends on, it's very market specific. So some illicit markets of trafficking, the majority of victims, especially sex trafficking, are women and girls. And so in those markets, having policies that address gender as specifically as possible is really important. But then if you look at some of the federal investigations on trafficking cases at large, it's still gender plus class plus race and ethnicity. The majority of victims of trafficking in the United States are primarily African American, Hispanic, and racial and ethnic minorities. And then if you look at gender identity and the number of LGBTQ young adults and youth who are impacted by trafficking, there are still very disproportionate rates of who's impacted. But then in terms of who's responsible, it is everyone. It is, when we look at cases, for the most part, the traffickers are coming from the communities of the victims. So the same racial and ethnic minority communities, or could be family members, people they know. But then if you look at the economic drivers around demand, it's those who have the ability to, who create that demand, which is a broader, it's all of us when it comes to global labor markets and corporate supply chains. And so it's hard to segment it out and separate it out. There are those disproportionately affected, and then we all have a role to play in contributing to the economic and social dynamics.
Assuming for a moment, and I hope it's not a stretch, that everyone in this room believes that slavery is wrong in whatever form and should be abolished. Someone asked, well, where are the abolitionists? Well, okay, here's a room full of abolitionists. Assuming that's the case, what's going to make you stop buying those beautiful grape tomatoes that are on sale for $1.99. If you know, if you're educated and learn, hypothetically, that those tomatoes were picked by people considered to be enslaved. In lived reality, what's going to make you an abolitionist in the practice of your life and how you spend your money? How do we move from, again, words to action?
Well, I do think that education and informing the public is very important. Like when I, you know, I haven't lived through the Great Boycott, you know, for 10 or 15 years, however long it took for the grape workers in California and elsewhere in our country to become organized under the efforts of Cesar Chavez and other people. People I know and myself didn't eat those grapes. So if you knew exactly which cell phones or which kinds of jewelry or which kinds of products, I think, you know, that you can build a large grassroots movement based on education, and that, you know, public-spirited people will tell their friends, tell their families, build movements.
As Dr. Vetter slips away, just thank you, Professor, for coming. Thank you. So how realistic is that? How realistic is it that behavior will change if the knowledge can be transferred and we learn the products, the minerals that go into whatever it is that we use that were cultivated through slave mining? Can we change behavior that will lessen the demand, which would actually abolish slavery? Or will we be talking about this in this room 150 years from now?
I'll give a couple of examples from the federal government. So the Department of Labor, they do issue reports on raw products and materials made by child labor and forced labor around the world. But then it's translating that to the consumer base of what does that mean? Which companies or which restaurants, et cetera? And so that's where it's the local, it has to be government and local communities. There's an organization in Florida, the Coalition of Immokalee Workers, where they've been working heavily on tomatoes, primarily produced in Florida, of getting major fast food chains to increase the amount of money that they're paying per pound of tomato. And they've made a lot of headway into grocery store chains, fast food chains. And then the federal government itself has President Obama passed an executive order to prevent taxpayer money from funding anything that the federal government may procure through any one of the departments so that we're not paying for goods and services produced by forced labor. So it's the transparency piece of how do we partner with research institutions, workers, local community members. And the will has to be across all those sectors, and the information needs to be shared. And then now tech companies are coming on board saying, all right, so if there's some of this information, how do we create apps and tools so that consumers can use that to have more option and choice in what they purchase? So I think it's a matter of all those sectors coming together and raising that level of practical awareness.
It's a question I asked many of my students. If you learned that the mutual funds that had been invested in to pay for your scholarship, in fact, were funding slave labor somewhere, people you'd never meet, you never know, would you be willing to give up your scholarship if you learned that? I think this is where the rubber hits the road, whether change will happen. Who's willing to sacrifice, and what does the sacrifice look like for a common good? Which goes right back to the very founding questions of our nation, who we are, the idea of a commonwealth versus private wealth. Yeah.
I wonder, Pamela, is there any product that is purely shining pure and free of any relationship to slave labor? I mean, if you get down to mining, I mean, the basic chemicals that go into our cell phones, into our herbicides, into our food chain, into everything we have, is there anything that is purely and absolutely pure and not related to slave labor? Is there anything?
I think that speaks to growing local, buying local, you know. So what if you have you know, local producers, local growers, and I think that's a big impetus for that whole movement, and that's where you find those things.
And working with Native people whose land that was originally.
But we live in a global economy, and I think it also makes a difference if there's a growing demand for from consumers for that level of transparency, that if consumers really want to know where products are produced and how they're produced. I know by us there's a nonprofit, Veritas, that goes and examines for companies what the working conditions are, where they're sourcing things in China, whatever. If that information became more public, it would be easier to act with our pocketbooks.
So in addition to the nutrition facts,
yeah.
quote-unquote nutrition facts,
yeah.
and the ingredients, maybe there's a box saying how it's sourced. Yeah. Yes?
How do you prevent from getting discouraged? I mean, you read history, you have thousands of years, then Hitler comes along. You think you're making progress, and it's discouraging.
It's a wonderful question that I'm not going to answer. Somebody brighter than I is going to answer. But I'll say that where I work now at Colonial Williamsburg, we run into this all the time, that we have a pantheon of American heroes and founders that really in our, the reason we exist is to enshrine who they are and the ideas that they instilled in the fabric of this nation. And we're in the process of adding new heroes. Adding new heroes and not subtracting heroes. But this is, it comes right back to that question. What is the function of education or a museum? And do we really want to be teaching second graders about slavery? It's hard. People are upset by it. And heck, I'm paying to come to your place on vacation. And I'm paying for trauma. You know, I have therapy after my family vacation. So no, these are legitimate questions. How, I think, and maybe this may be our final idea to try to wrap our heads around, but how do we convey this, the weight? Seriously, I mean, I was just slinking in my chair, listening to your stories, the weight of your experiences, where you've been, and the burdens that you're carrying, there's a weight to it. And you could see that in Lincoln's photographs before his election and by the end of his presidency, just the weight. You know, Walt Whitman, I think, wrote about it, standing there watching him. He looked like a wounded soldier by the end. There's a weight. So, but we want to inspire. We want to solve. We've got to move forward. We have moved forward, and we should be proud of that. How do we do it? How do we balance it? What's the message that's true but also inspiring?
And some of what we put out was really heavy. And this is a person who's been in and out of incarceration for 40 years and is doing a master's degree and is here standing before you presenting and working on collective education as well as his own. I mean, that's pretty hopeful to me. So just the fact that we're able to have some of the conversations we're having, some of these conversations just don't take place in a lot of spaces. So some of those things say to me, okay, something is germinating.
So I'm just thinking of Lincoln and his use of metaphors and stories. And if you permit me to share a nightmare I had last night, but there were some lessons in there about this question of hope. So in this dream last night, I was in a house, multi-room, like many people, each person to a room, and an infant was abandoned at the doorstep. We brought him in, and I went around saying, okay, this baby needs a place to be, and everyone was saying, no, it can't be with me, this baby can't be with me, and so it was no, all around in this collective group house. And I'm also pregnant, but anyway, what happened, it was almost like a Groundhog Day type of dream, and so then one person comes from outside the house and says, I'll take that baby, and so we're all like, great, we don't have to take responsibility for it, let's give it to this person. Fast forward many years, and I come across this now grown adult who experience all sorts of levels of violence, because in my dream, the one person who said, I will take this baby in, was a trafficker. And so although it sounds hopeless and really tragic and sad, because that's the reality for a lot of people experiencing violence, I actually saw it as a very hopeful dream of that Hitler. Like, Hitler is one person versus the collective many of us that, and it's always this choice. And so I woke up with this lesson of how do we collectively as a community say yes to whatever it is that baby needs, so that we're not enabling the traffickers or the Hitlers or the people who are intending harm and violence to get away with it so easily. And so I think that's where it's that balance of there are people with ill intent who commit violence and exploitation, and maybe they have their own trauma, but the majority of us, we're all abolitionists in this room, the majority of us want freedom for others, and then it's just a matter of the lessons we've learned from the folks working on peace and reconciliation of how do we knit that together as a community, because it seems so overwhelming alone to do it on our own. And so it's the community, at least for me, that brings in that hope in a pretty harsh reality on the day to day. So thank you for enabling me to share.
And I can only imagine that doing the kind of work that you are doing, that sustaining that hope, is key to doing your work. And it's a remarkable person who can sustain that hope over so many years to carry the message forward.
I just have to quickly say that I get my hope from the people I work with in these parts of the world that have been ravaged. And they're just extraordinary people doing extraordinary things. And I think there's a balance between getting weighted by the horrors of it on the one hand, or becoming Pollyanna-ish on the other, but that I really do think that we hear the horror stories, and we don't hear enough of the extraordinary things that people are doing at the grassroots level all over the world.
I want to just add one quick thing, because during the civil unrest in Baltimore, we had a student group come down here, and Callie and Michelle, I think, would be happy to share that story with all of you, but we also have it published on our website, so I encourage you to look that up, because one thing that was moving to all of us is that these students, in the throes of violence in their own community, really had powerful things to say, and an incredible amount of hope. Mm-hmm. And in coming here, for really the first time, felt connected to that history and saw their place in it, and that drives us every day.
This is an incredible space. These spaces need to exist. And President Lincoln's Cottage, under Aaron's amazing direction, Callie, the whole team, this is a place where these conversations happen. And, you know, I'll carry this forward with me for months and months and months. And I think we all will. So thank you for making this happen. Thank you for convening us, and thank you for coming.